Welcome to Love Fellowship Believers. Hey, we're in a new location. We're at 200 North Bimbo Road here in the beautiful city of Greensboro on the wonderful campus of North Carolina A&T. We're there in the Alumni Event Center. We want you to come out and fellowship with us. We want you to have a wonderful time with us. Please, 200 North Bimbo Road. Now join us already in service.
Our message today is coming out of the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 9. 1 Corinthians chapter 9. And we're going to be in verse 24. God, I'm thanking you for my voice returning. Speaking those things that be not as though they were. Since that little bout with whatever that infection was, you know, I've been having a little bit of difficulty hitting the notes. But you know what?
Praise God.
This too shall pass.
Amen.
It's but a light affliction. Hallelujah. We're at 1 Corinthians 9:24. When you're there, say amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. If you need more time, say wait a minute. And the Bible reads this way, and I'm reading from the King James. Know ye not that they which run in a race run all? In other words, we are all in a race. We're all running in a race. We are human beings, so at least we are running in the human race. Amen? But one receives the prize. Even though we're all running, only one will break the tape at the finish line. That one will receive the prize. So run that you may obtain what? The prize. I love Paul because he gives such, you know, graphic illustrations to, you know, what this Christian race is all about. He uses athletes to, you know, a lot of times describe or make the point that he's trying to drive home. He's telling us today that we're all in the race, but we can't just run this race any kind of way. We can't sit on the sideline of do nothing and watch the race go by. As Christians, we're in the race.
Amen.
But we can't run it just any kind of way. We can't run it with baggage. We can't run it with those weights and sins that so easily beset us. We've got to strip those things off so that we can run to obtain the prize. Every man that strives for the mastery is temperate. And our message today is coming from that one word, temperate. Because in the body of Christ, there are too many of us that don't have self-control. Temperate. Self-discipline. Control over yourself. Control over your flesh. Subjecting your flesh to the Holy Spirit. You don't belong to yourself. As a child of God, you belong to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And the servant doesn't tell the master what he's going to do, when he's going to do it, and how it is to be done.
That's right.
When you have, you know, no self-control, you're basically telling God, I'm in control. I hope you're hearing me this morning.
Yes, we are.
Amen.
But he says, we have to be masters in temperance. Not just, you know, temperate, but we've got to master this thing. And it's not in just a few things, but it's in all things. Now they do it to obtain a corruptible crown. In other words, they run, the world runs, to obtain a corruptible crown. The world runs to obtain popularity. The world runs to obtain fame and glory. The world runs to increase their bank account. But how many of you know when you're stretched out before the altar, there is never a U-Haul or a rider parked behind it? You're not taking anything that you acquire in this earth with you out of this earth. So seek you first the kingdom of God and his right ways of doing things, and everything else will be added unto you. But guess what? You're not running this race to attain a corruptible crown, but you're running this race to attain an incorruptible crown. A crown that was not made by hands. The blacksmith or the jeweler can't make this crown. You know, this crown is made by the Holy Spirit. This crown is fashioned and shaped just for you. It doesn't fit your neighbor's head. It doesn't fit your children's head. But it fits your head and yours alone. An incorruptible crown. Verse 26, I therefore so run. So I run in this race. Not as uncertainty. So fight I not as one that beats the air. When you give, you know, right now he's talking about, you know, somebody who basically is just running, elbows flashing, beating the air, but going nowhere. Or like a boxer, you know, who's shadow boxing. He's up and he's beating the bags, you know, but he's not hitting anything. How many of you know that when a fighter is fighting against his opponent, it takes more energy out of him when he swings and misses than it does when he connects? So that's why when they're scoring the bout, they'll fight, you'll see that they score punches thrown and punches landed. Usually the person who has more punches landed is going to win the fight. Unless there's by some chance a knockout. You know, some technical problem. Somebody get cut, you know, and can't fix the cut, you know. But, you know, we're talking about, you know, basically conserving your energy. Run the race and don't beat the air so that you can run to obtain the prize. Amen. We fight against ourselves when we are disobedient. And I've been dealing with this subject for quite some time, Pastor Webb. We just seem to know that, you know, we can't do anything any kind of way. We can't just do our own thing. We've got to be obedient to the Word of God. Too many Christians today are neglecting the Word of God and just doing their own thing, and there's no, they think there's no accountability. But you will be held accountable. The Bible says, for the man who knows to do right and doesn't, to him it's a sin.
Yeah.
I wonder how many of you, even when you commit sin against God, have the respect for God to say, God, I'm sorry. Forgive me, God, for the sin I committed against you. Or how many of you just go right on living your life? Go right on doing that same thing that you know is an offense against God and never ever think that you owe him an apology.
That's a good word.
There are many that are just piling up sin. And you need to check your relationship with him, because you might be in a backslidden state. When other things begin to take more priority in your life, when those things begin to take more precedence with you than the Word of God, than the commandments of God, then guess what? You might be in a backslidden state. There's no might. There's no maybe. You are in a backslidden state. And you need to come to repentance before you close your eyes, before you find yourself in a situation that you can't come back from. Hear me this morning.
Yes.
I therefore so run, not as uncertainty, so fight I not as one that beats the air, but I keep under my body and bring it into subjection, lest that by any means, when I have preached to others, I myself should become a castaway. I myself should become disqualified from the race. Preaching to others, but disqualified.
Amen.
Sometimes, you know, it's not the words that you say, but when they know that you are a child of God, when they know that you belong to Jesus Christ, you know, they're looking for an example from you. And sometimes, you know, just by your actions, you're preaching to others. Oh no, you didn't ask to, you know, to be a preacher. You didn't ask to come into the fivefold ministry, but you did ask to come into the body of Christ, and by doing so, you accepted the ministry of reconciliation.
Wow. Amen.
How many of you remember when you were young teenagers? Some of us got to think back a little ways because we've been in this world for a little bit now, you know. But, you know, to God, you're still just a teenager. To God, you're still just a knee baby. To God, you're still just a child.
Amen.
But does anybody remember when you got your driver's license for the first time?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Uh-huh. Can you think back to then? Do you remember the time you spent training, the time you spent, you know, learning how to drive? And I know some of you hadn't had your license very long yet. You've not even renewed your first one yet, you know. So you're still just a young driver, amen. And we're watching out for you when we're out there on the road. I know you know, you think that we drive too slow. I know you think that, you know, we drive like Miss Daisy. I know you think that, you know, but something. I know. See, I'm getting some vibes here. I know some of them know that I don't drive like Miss Daisy, you know. some of them know that I'll put my foot down. Hallelujah. But, you know, we know that some of the, I'm looking though, you know, when I'm out there, and even though I may have a few more skills and more experience at driving than, you know, some young people, but some of y'all drive like, oh my goodness. And you know what, young ladies, y'all used to didn't drive like that. Y'all used to didn't try to blow people's doors off. Hallelujah. But how many of you remember the amount of time that it went into preparing you to get your driver's license? You didn't just, you know, say all of a sudden I'm going to jump into the car and I'm going to go down to DMV and I'm going to get my driver's license. No, you had to pick up the book. You had to study the rules. You knew that there was going to be a written test, and then you had to pass the test. And not only the written test, but you had to take the road test.
Amen.
And how many of you know that, you know, when that DMV operator came out, there was terror on his face. Uh-huh. And those driver education teachers, you know, they looked petrified when some of y'all got under the wheel. And then there was a look of regret on your parents' faces when you came back and said, "I passed the test." See? That means that, you know, they now want, you know, a set of car keys. And they don't want, you know, the old hoopties, you know, that mama and them used to buy us, brother, you know.
Don't hurt it.
That's right. And you know what? And the other thing was, you know, mama and them didn't buy us nothing when it came to, you know, buying, you know, a car. In those days, guess what? If you got your license, you better. In my case, I didn't have anything to drive when I got my license. So what was the use? It took me a little while, you know, to save up to get my first car. And me and my wife sit here today celebrating our 35th wedding anniversary in July. Amen. You know, we bought our first car together. Amen. You know, and that thing, man, I'm telling you, they when they say Ford fixed or repaired daily, found on the road dead. Oh my God, we had so much trouble with that Ford. You know, and it was a Ford Torino GT with a 351 Cleveland engine. So every time I pulled up to the stop sign, somebody wanted to roll. You know, back in them days, boy, they had some hot rods. They had the Chevelle 396 and the GTO, the GOAT, you know. They had muscle cars back then, Camaros and, you know, and Mustangs. And, you know, and every time somebody pulled up beside mine, they thought that I had, you know, a racing engine in that thing and that I was going to run it. Every time I ran it, guess what? I may as well get ready to go right on to the dealer, right on to the mechanic, you know, and fix this thing again, you know. So I stopped that racing.
Thank you, God.
Hallelujah. But finally, you gain control over this 2,000-pound metal object. It's called an automobile. It took a while, but you finally figured it out, which pedal to push, which way to turn the car to make it go. You know, you finally, you know, got control of this thing. You even learned how to parallel park. But I know, you know, that ain't true for everybody, because I can just stand in front of our building, brother, and when they come up and try to, you know, parallel park in front of Gilbert County Human Resources, you know, they oh my goodness, that is a spectacle to watch. That is a spectacle to behold. They don't know. You know, some try to go in forward. You know, ain't enough space. You know that already. You know that the best way to parallel park is to back that thing in. You know, but so many folk, you know, have difficulty, or they either depth perception is not, you know, what it should be. And so, you know, they're just challenged when it comes to parallel parking. But that's all right, you know. Just wait a little while. Somebody, you know, finally say, hey, come. Let me park this thing for you. But I guess that's what they're hoping, you know. Yeah. Oh my, that's right. This is a technology age that we're living in. And yeah, they do have cars now that will park themselves. You know, some of us probably can't afford them, but they got them. Not yet, we can't afford them, you know. Just wait a while, you know. I'm of the mindset that, you know, it's probably better to wait till that thing's about 1.5, 2 years old before you try to buy it in the first place, you know. Because that price is so jacked up on the lot. I've had a couple off the showroom floor. I've had a couple that was off the lot, you know. But guess what? When I got that thing, I regretted them payments. I regretted them payments. I mean, because as soon as you, and in one case, you know, we had a situation where we traded that thing in something like less than 6 months, you know, after we bought it. Immaculate condition. Still had the plastic over the carpet. They depreciated that thing so bad that the next car I went into, I was in an upside down deal. You don't win. You know, you might as well wait till they drop the price on it. So you're finally in control of something. Solomon said in the book of Proverbs, he said, he who is slow to anger is better than the mighty, and he who rules his spirit than he who takes a city. In other words, you got to have control over yourself, or you are out of the will of God. Mm-hmm. If you don't have temperance, if you don't have self-control, guess what? You're the one in control, and that's not in God's will. The Bible calls it witchcraft. Because that's rebellion. He says rebellion is as stubbornness is as iniquity, and rebellion is as witchcraft, and I will not allow a witch to live. It's just that serious with God. When you decide that you're going to refuse to accept God's word, when you reject his word, when you take matters into your own hands, when you decide that, you know, I'm big and bad enough to do it my own way, you are in rebellion. And that's witchcraft. You got to get it together. You need to get it together. He also says it's great to have power. It's great to have control. But if you can't control yourself, it's not worth much. Conquering a city is nothing compared to conquering the habits that enslave you.
Amen.
Controlling an automobile is nothing compared to controlling your temper or your tongue. So I want to talk to you today about self-discipline. Self-discipline. What is self-discipline? What is discipline? When you think about the word discipline, there are a couple, you know, analogies that probably come to mind. To a child, it probably means getting a spanking when you do something bad. Do something that you shouldn't have done. To a soldier, discipline means controlling, you know, conforming to the rules and the regulations. Being obedient to those in authority over you. Or you might find yourself doing KP duty. Reveille on cold, ice cold mornings in North Dakota. Minot, North Dakota. Why not Minot? Freezing's the reason. Ain't that right, son? My son was stationed at Minot, North Dakota, and he was law enforcement, so that means he had to be exposed to those sub-zero degree temperatures. And you know that if you don't have self-control in a situation like that, guess what? You find yourself a popsicle out there. Uh-huh. Find yourself perished. I know your pastor, you know, served some time in the United States Navy. He knows something about, you know, conforming to rules and regulations. You know, when God basically, you know, puts you under authority, it's for preparation for when you are placed in authority. When you're basically faithful over a few, he'll make you ruler over many. But that's God's order. You can't be placed placed in authority if you're not self-disciplined, if you don't have any control over yourself? How can you lead others? I can talk this morning about being late to church. That's a lack of self-control. I can talk about not attending. That's a lack of self-control. I could talk about, you know, a number of things, you know, basically using your gifts and your talents so that you don't wear out a very few that are willing to submit their gifts and talents for the glory of God. If you don't use the gifts and talents that God has given you, you're wearing somebody else out.
Amen.
You're not here just to be a spectator.
That's right.
You're not here, you know, to sit on the sideline. You're in the race. To a student, discipline may mean a lot of homework. Guess what? You got to buckle down and do the work.
Amen.
Yes. The teacher's not going to say, okay, for you, you don't have to do it. I'll still give you a good grade.
That's
no, there's a syllabus that they provide you. There's, you know, it tells you from the very beginning of the course what is expected of you. Uh-huh. Read the syllabus. Read the syllabus. There's a book of instructions that God has given us.
Amen.
It's called Route 66.
Yeah.
It's the 66 book.
Yeah.
All right. He tells us, you know, how we are to conduct ourselves, how we are to control ourselves as Christians.
That's right.
Amen.
But all those things are examples of imposed discipline. Somebody sets the standards. Somebody imposes that discipline on you. A parent disciplines a child to teach him obedience. The army disciplines a soldier to teach them strict obedience. A school disciplines a student by making them do the work. And a church disciplines in order to encourage members to remain faithful.
Uh-huh.
But these are all imposed
Amen.
Disciplines.
Amen.
It's like controlling your dog when you're walking him on a leash. If you got your dog on a leash, guess what? He's under
That's
your control.
Right.
Uh-huh. You're walking him. He's, you know, baddest dog in the neighborhood and everything, you know, but he's under your control. But how would he act if you didn't
right.
have the leash around his neck?
Right.
Some of us need a leash.
Amen. Ooh, Lord.
Some of us need a leash around our neck, and some of us need a choke collar with spikes on it. Inverted spikes. That dig in every time you decide that you are not going to be obedient.
Jesus.
So the dog is forced to obey. They're forced to stay put and keep up with you. Let's give an example of overeating. Take that for an example. If that's a problem for you, you could place a large chain and padlock around the refrigerator. I know some of y'all fasting already. Maybe y'all got a padlock on y'all refrigerator. You know how your husband is. Come 2 o'clock in the morning, you know, when the munchies hit, you know, it's time to, you know, to creep, you know, downstairs and get a, you know, a snack or two, you know. So sometimes in order to help him, you know, to be faithful to the fast, you might have to put a padlock on the refrigerator. Anybody ever had to put a padlock on the refrigerator? No, we don't do that these days, do we? Thank you, Lord Jesus, for deliverance, you know. I mean, but there was a time when there was like when mama had to raise 7 of you. And she knew. Yeah, that she had to lock that thing because some people were getting more than their share. Everybody didn't get, you know, a part of what was in the refrigerator, so she padlocked that thing. They're not everybody's mama, just yours, baby. And she kept the key hidden. And sometimes she hid it from herself. And that posed a problem. What about if you have a problem driving the speed limit? Anybody have a problem like this? Anybody need a governor placed on your automobile? Anybody remember when they used to do that? I know when I was moving my family, when we went into the Air Force, brother, we had, Deb and I were already married a year already, so we had acquired enough furniture to, you know, to furnish our apartment and everything. So when we finished with our, you know, technical training, we had to come back here, load everything up, and because she was going to Michigan and I was in California, you know, and with a follow-on to Michigan, you know, because I wasn't leaving my baby up in Michigan while I was in California, so we got a joint spouse assignment, amen? Praise God. But we came back here loaded up, and the vehicle that I had to drive was a U-Haul truck with a stick shift, and I didn't know how to drive a stick shift at that time, so I went out at night on a school bus to learn how to drive a stick shift. The next morning, I had it down. The next morning, you know, I was able to drive that truck, at least off the lot. I know I scraped them people's gears from here to New Jersey, from Jersey to Michigan. Because I wasn't driving across the West Virginia mountains with a truck, you know, with a stick shift. I heard about them West Virginia mountains, so I wasn't driving across West Virginia's mountains just learning how to drive a stick shift. So we went 95 north, 80 across to 75, and 75 north to 23 north to get to this isolated assignment up in the northern peninsula of Michigan. By the time we got that truck there, I know they had to put a new transmission in there. Better their truck than mine. I rented that thing. But guess what? We made the trip. But it had a governor on it. You couldn't drive more than 55 miles an hour. No matter how hard you try. Some of us need a governor on ourselves. But there's another kind of discipline that I want to talk to you about for Christians this morning, and that's called self-discipline. It's found in Galatians 5:22, and Sister Bell has already, you know, hit on it this morning when she talked to you about the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control is one of the fruit of the Spirit. We've got to have control of ourselves.
Amen.
Yes.
This is one of the Christian graces that we grow in. We ask, Peter said in 2 Peter 1 and 5, he says, add to your faith virtue, and to virtue knowledge, and to knowledge self-control. In other words, it is a character. You know, we describe the fruit of the Spirit as the character of God: love, joy, peace, goodness, meekness, temperance, faith. Against such there is no law. There's no law that affects God, because why? He's all of that. And he expects us to grow in grace. He expects us to mature in the body of Christ. So in order for us to mature in the body of Christ, we have to apply self-discipline, self-control. The reason self-control is so important to us is that we don't have anybody telling us what to do. Now, some religions work rings around Christians.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, they do.
They're more faithful. They're more committed. They're more dedicated to their faith than we are as Christians. Why? Because we don't have a formula of how we're to do this and how we're to do that. We're not ritualistic. We have freedom. The Bible says where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. But the Spirit of the Lord is our self-control. He controls us when we're obedient to Him. But we are disobedient to Him, and so we are out of control. You got some faiths that tell you, okay, you got to face the east and pray five times a day. But Christ doesn't tell us that that's what we ought to do in the Christian faith. But He does say, pray without ceasing. So if we pray without ceasing, we're praying more than five times a day.
Amen.
We're praying more than five times a day as Christians in the body of Christ. You know, because every time the Holy Spirit brings it to your mind, you ought to go into prayer right then and there. You don't have to be in your prayer closet every time you pray. You don't have to be in church every time you pray. I know that's when some of you do it, but, you know, that's not the only time. And the pastor's not the only one who can pray.
Amen.
get tired sometimes, brother, when, you know, same folk answer altar call for the same thing all the time. That tells me that you don't have any self-control. That tells me that you're not applying the word. That tells me that you want me, as Creflo Dollar gave an illustration about this today. Some guy, you know, that he was traveling through the airport, you know, wanted him, oh man of God, I want you to lay hands on me and pray for me. Impart to me. You know, and he tells the man, get up. He says, you can't get in one head scratching what it's taken me, you know, 30 years to get. Go and study to show yourselves approved unto God, a workman that need not be ashamed, but able to rightly divide the word of truth. Study to show yourselves approved unto God. Don't put that responsibility on your pastor to be the only one studying, and so that he can just lay hands on you and you got everything he's got that it took him 30 years to acquire. Study. It takes a lot more character to have self-discipline to do something on your own than it does to be told what, when, and how to do it.
Amen.
Paul has given us the illustration of the race. He talks about, in this passage of scripture, he says, do you not know that those who run in a race all run, but only one receives the prize? He says, run in such a way that you may obtain it. And everyone who competes for the prize is temperate. Everyone who competes for the prize has self-control in how many things? In all things. Now they that do it attain a corruptible crown, but we for an imperishable crown. Therefore I run thus, not with uncertainty. Thus I fight, not as one who beats the air, but I discipline my body and bring it into subjection, lest when I have preached to others, I myself should become disqualified. Don't disqualify yourself by being out of control.
Good word. Thank you, God.
He uses the illustration of an athlete competing in a race, which was very familiar to the Corinthians. The Greeks had two athletic events. They had the Olympic Games and they had the Isthmian Games, which were held in Corinth every 3 years. In fact, if you go to Corinth, I understand you can see the areas where the races were run, the starting blocks, where the athletes started out. The races are still embedded in the stones. Wow. And Paul uses this figure because to him, the Christian race is like running a race. The Corinthians knew that every athlete who participated in the races had to take an oath that they had been training for 10 months. How many of us have to take an oath that as Christians we've been in training for 10 months? Some of us come into the body of Christ, and we expect that by overnight that we will have all the knowledge that, you know, the pastor has. No, you know, it's going to take you spending some time in orientation. It's going to take some time, you know, spending times in the word. It's going to take some time you coming to church on time. It's going to take some time with you, you know, hearing the word of God across the book board, but also becoming doers of that word. Sooner or later, all of us ask the question, why am I here? Why am I in the race? And of course, the answer from the Bible is God intends to use you. See, you don't come into the Christian race to sit down on the sidelines to watch the race. No, you're in the race. There is something that you have that God has deposited within you before the foundations of the world. In your mother's womb, he knew you and ordained you a prophet before the nations. So there is a gift or talent that you have that God wants to collect on.
Amen.
He deposited it. And at the set time, he wants to use you.
Amen.
I don't believe we realize what an honor that is, that God wants to use little old me. Somebody who was born on the south side of the city. Somebody who was born into poverty. Somebody who, you know, knew what, you know, hunger pains felt like. Somebody who, you know, didn't, you know, Folk would write you off as being insignificant. I know, brother, you know, when I was in school, you know, just because of where I came from, they thought that I would not have the aptitude to be able to compete academically. And I don't know what it was. I guess it was the Spirit of God, because it always inspired me to compete even harder, to prove to them that even though I came from a lower socioeconomic, you know, condition, I didn't have to stay there. I got a couple of degrees that can attest to the fact that, you know, I can accomplish academically. That's not bragging, that's just saying that where I was written off from the beginning, because I had dirty clothes, because I had holes in my jeans, because my shoes were talking sometimes. Y'all know what I mean? When the soles on your shoe, you know, come separate from the shoe, and you come flapping in the class and everything, you know, and sometimes you're wearing the same thing over and over and over again, and you late with your book fees.
Yes.
And they write you off as though there's no hope for you. But Jesus Christ. I was saved when I was 9 years old. So the boundaries for me, God had already set. I was not to, because of undiscipline, go in directions that I saw other people going in. I had to move forward. I had to do what He had ordained for me to do. My footsteps were ordained by Him before the foundations of the world.
Thank you, God.
And even if I wanted to participate in some of the stuff that my homeboys were doing, I couldn't do it because there was a boundary drawn for me.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you.
I can remember when I accepted my call into ministry, I was in Korea. And God just showed me, you know, that He deposited within me, it had to be self-discipline, because I was finding myself going to this little chapel with snow out on the ground, snow everywhere, my footsteps looking behind were on their way to this little chapel. And it wasn't that many people at the chapel. It was only a few folks, you know, that were committed to the Word of God, who wanted to study, who wanted to hear the Word of God. So He directed me through the snow to this little bitty chapel. Wasn't very many folks there even on Sundays, but there were more on Sunday than there were at Bible study. You know what I'm talking about. That's true around the nation, everywhere, you know, every Wednesday night there's fewer people there, because you don't have the thirst and the hunger for the Word that you do on Sunday. Because sometimes on Sunday it becomes about religion when we, you know, matriculate to the church doors and everything, because, you know, that's what's expected of us. No, God wants more from you than that. He wants you to hunger and thirst for His Word. His Word is a treasure in the earth. And we forsake the Word as though it means absolutely nothing. It's just one of the books. Another book to read. People of the Old Testament would have loved to have had these 66 books that we have today. All they had was the Ten Commandments. And that was after the children left Egypt, when God gave them the Ten Commandments. You know, so before Egypt, guess what? They didn't have even the 66 books. All they had then was the two. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, and soul, and love your neighbor as you love yourself. That was all He said. But we couldn't get those right. He said, on these two hangs all the laws. Then the Ten Commandments came. Then the Old Testament came. Then the New Testament came. And Jesus says, it is finished. Amen. Don't add to or take away from this Word. So when you come, you know, come up with a third testament, I don't know what spirit you're hearing from, but it's not the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Why do we need to be disciplined? One philosopher said, only the disciplined ever get really good at anything. If you don't have discipline, guess what? You won't get good at what you're doing.
Amen.
you'll just be mediocre. You'll just be average. That's the best you'll be, is average, because you have no discipline. Whether it's hitting a baseball, whether it's climbing a mountain, playing a musical instrument, or making good grades, it all comes down to a matter of discipline. Many of us have ambitions that are never going to be realized. Goals that will never be reached. Visions that will never materialize, simply because we have no discipline. It's not that you can't achieve, it's that you won't allow yourself to be under control. It's not that God is holding anything from you.
That's right. Say that.
He says, I will not withhold any good thing from you. So it's his good pleasure that you prosper and be in good health, even as your soul prospers. So, you know, it's not him keeping it away from you. Don't tell that lie on God. Got to do a self-examination, do an internal self-inspection, run your checklist, see what it is that's getting more attention than God is. When you ask a child what they want to be when they grow up, many of them, they got high aspirations.
Yes.
I want to be a banker. I want to be an entrepreneur. Don't even know what that means yet, but that's what they want to be. I want to be a doctor, I want to be a lawyer, I want to be a scientist, I want to be an engineer, I want to be a pro athlete, I want to be a construction contractor, I want to be a musician. But all of these require discipline. All of them require self-control. All of them require you making a plan to get where it is that you're trying to go. When you use a haphazard approach, when you do the hit and miss, when you take one step forward and two steps back, guess what? You won't realize your goal. John Wesley used to travel an average of 20 miles a day for 40 years. He got up every morning at 4 o'clock in the morning. God bless you, Brother John Wesley. God bless you. Bro Andre, you, I know, bro. I know you. You Yeah, but you didn't have to do it every day for 40 years, 4 o'clock in the morning. And listen, this was not imposed discipline. This was his own self-discipline. He did this because that's what he thought he needed to do in order to bring glory to God. So he preached 40,000 sermons.
Yes.
He produced 400 books and knew 10 languages. And at the age of 83, he was annoyed because he couldn't write more than 15 hours a day without hurting his eyes. And at the age of 86, he was ashamed that he couldn't preach more than twice a day. He complained in his diary that there was an increasing tendency to lie in bed until 5:30 in the morning. How would you like Brother John Wesley to be your pastor? Wow. Trust me, I'm not suggesting we all accept this kind of schedule. But it's still true that the person who learns the power of self-discipline is going to be the person who accomplishes great things. You will not achieve greatness being mediocre.
Amen.
Being without control. In what areas of our lives do we need discipline? Well, number one, we need discipline over our minds. We need to train ourselves to think. That's why we can't take off the helmet of salvation. We have to keep on the whole armor of God, because the enemy is steady more throwing fiery darts at you. And if you don't realize that you are a target, then you're deceiving yourself. Paul wrote in 2 Timothy 2:15, he said, study to show yourselves approved to God, a workman that needs not be ashamed, but able to rightly divide the word of truth. We need discipline over our minds in church. In other words, if you don't study the word of God, you don't have any discipline over your mind. Somebody has to impose it on you. Somebody has to pour into you. But self-discipline says, I open this book for myself.
Yes.
Or if you got your Bible on your cell phone, I go into the Bible for myself to study the scriptures. And don't just, you know, use the Bible by itself. Always use commentaries so that you can refer to the scriptures by subject. There are so many other sources that we have that will help you to study the word of God. Number two, we also need to discipline our bodies. And some of us ain't been to the Y since we bought the membership. Forgive us, God. Forgive us. I've been a few times, but Lord, it's been a while. It's time to go again.
Amen.
And that's not a New Year's resolution, because I don't make New Year's resolutions. I just, you know, say, God, I'm going to do better than I did last year.
Amen.
Paul says that bodily exercise profits a little. In 1 Timothy 4:8, our bodies are all we have to serve God with. And certainly it makes sense that we do that. The better we take care of our bodies, the better we are able to serve God. So don't wait until you get old. That's why my wife was saying in the opening of the service today that when you wait too late, you know, when you wait until your age, the body, you know, has become so, you know, you got a whole lot of ailments and things that's going on that don't allow you to run the race as quickly as you could have when you were young.
That's right.
You got stuff on
you. Yeah, you got weights on you. Number three, we need a disciplined moral character. Same passage of scripture, 1 Timothy 4:8, for bodily exercise profits a little, but godliness is profitable in all things. A disciplined body is of great value, but a disciplined character is of a greater value. The discipline represented by years of study in medical or law school can't replace the much needed discipline of character.
Amen.
What does it profit a man to gain the whole world but to lose his soul? Guess what? There are many people who have studied and become lawyers or doctors, you know, but they don't have any control over their moral character. So guess what? Pretty soon they find themselves in trouble with the law. They find themselves discredited, they find themselves disbarred, they find themselves embarrassed in their profession because they have no control, no self-discipline over their moral character.
Amen.
They make decisions and choices that appease the flesh, that satisfies the flesh, that brings their body pleasure. And that's their whole motivation. The whole thing that drives them is pleasure to the flesh. Lust of the eyes, of the flesh, and of the pride of life. A lack of moral character could cause him or her their reputation, their practice, and even their life or soul. What do you think Michael Jackson's doctor feels like now? They say that his doctor, during the time that Michael Jackson was in trouble when he was dying, they say that he had over 40 text messages and phone calls where he was on the telephone, you know, communicating with friends and buddies when Michael Jackson needed him to be administering CPR. That damaged his reputation, his professional character, because he didn't have control over his moral character. Number four, we need discipline over our appetite. In Proverbs 25:16, Solomon said, you have found honey. Or he says, he asked the question, have you found honey? Then he says, eat only as much as you need, lest you be filled with it and vomit and puke. and forgive me, and throw up. Because you're gluttony. Because you're eating more than you need. And you know, we don't deal with gluttony like we used to in the old days, brother. I know, you know, that old pastor was about 85 years old when, you know, when I was a young child in the church, you know, and he used to preach on gluttony a lot. That was a sin. But preachers don't preach on that as much as they used to, because preachers love themselves a piece of fried chicken. They love themselves some, you know, biscuit, you know, with gravy stains running all down their white shirt. They love themselves, you know, a smorgasbord or a buffet somewhere around town. Y'all know what I'm talking about. You know, when we were down east, brother, guess what? Help somebody. Yeah. Now, your pastor ain't one of them. You can look at him and tell he got some self-control. But you know, we don't deal with gluttony like we used to because, you know, we ourselves like a good piece of chicken. We ourselves, uh-oh, come on now. We got Popeyes in town now. Watch out now. And they open for business. They up here on Piscataquis Road, you know, before you know it, they'll be everywhere around here putting some competition on. But we don't deal with gluttony like we used to. Number five, we need discipline over our mouth. I read a sign the other day, you know, just yesterday, going home, I saw one church marquee that says, less Facebook and more of God's book.
Amen.
You got a lot of preachers out there just chatting away on Facebook, and many of them are bordering on gossip. Many of them have cliques in the church, and they're talking to, you know, their best friends in the church, and they're in leadership, and there should not be any cliques in the church. No matter how self-controlled you are, if you haven't bridled your tongue, you got to still a long ways to go. James 1:26, if anyone among you thinks he is religious and does not bridle his tongue but deceives his heart, this one's religion is useless. And then he says in James 3:2, for we all stumble in many things. If anyone does not stumble in word, he is a perfect man.
Amen.
Able to also bridle the whole body. So, you know, when we can bridle the tongue, we have self-control. Take self-control to be able to do it. Some people pride themselves on being frank, you know, and I want you to hear this. Because we as African Americans really have a problem with this. I just speak my mind. I just say what's on my mind. I am just frank. In other words, what they're saying is I just say what I think. But according to the Bible, that's what a fool does. Proverbs 29:11, a fool vents all his feelings, but a wise man holds them back. It requires a lot more discipline to refrain from speaking at all. Y'all know we, you know, quick to give folks a piece of our mind, like we got some spare reserve, you know, that we can afford to, you know, to give somebody a piece of it, you know. We need all the mind that we have, and then some. Study to show yourself approved, to increase and enhance the brain cells. Don't deteriorate the brain cells. Don't be giving parts of it away because you're gonna need it. Number six, we need discipline in arranging our priorities. Matthew 6:33, seek first the kingdom of God, and all other things will be added unto you. But let me say in closing that there are also some dangers to discipline. There's some dangers to self-discipline. Before you get the idea that because you have self-discipline, you have arrived, let me tell you, there are some dangers. Self-discipline by itself doesn't make us right with God. There are some people who have self-discipline but don't know God in the least. So a right relationship with God is the most important thing. In Colossians 2, Paul rebukes the Christians because some of them were laying down a lot of strict rules. Don't touch this and don't taste that. Don't handle this, thinking that a lot of rules would make them right with God, but they didn't. The Pharisees were highly disciplined people, but their hearts were far from God.
That's right.
We need to remember that discipline is only a servant to be used in our efforts to glorify God.
Amen. Amen.
Secondly, we need to be careful that discipline doesn't fill us with pride.
Yes.
Pride goes before destruction and a haughty spirit before the fall. There are many people, ask Bishop Eddie Long, who became prideful. Ask Bishop Jim Wright over in Charlotte, who's now incarcerated for fleecing the flock, for basically demanding huge sums of money, hundreds of thousands of dollars, when the church was in financial ruin. And he was already a wealthy man with two funeral homes. So he didn't really need to, you know, live the exorbitant lifestyle that he was living while the church was struggling. I'm not passing judgment, but I'm saying those are examples that we don't want to find ourselves in. Third, there is a danger of imposing too harsh a discipline. And there's a word that's called asceticism. Asceticism is denying yourself anything that brings pleasure. So you got some people, you know, that are like monks and other religious men of past ages. They didn't marry, they didn't eat much, and some of them even wore rough, hairy shirts and put stones in their shoes. Asceticism focuses on prohibition, what you can't do. And that's why a lot of people don't come to Christianity, because some have been, you know, been more about religion than they've been about relationship with God. And so, you know, they don't know that where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. They only know a bunch of rules. And so, you know, we got a bunch of can't do this and can't do that. And so they don't want any parts of religion. Yet they see us doing whatever we want to do, but we preaching don't do, can't do. Mm-hmm. Asceticism focuses on prohibitions and rules concerning things that are petty. Discipline deals with things that will help us to be better people. Amen. And better Christians. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. Paul spoke of false teachers, forbidding to marry and commanding to abstain from foods which God created to be received with thanksgiving by those who believe and know the truth. For instance, living on bread and water is asceticism. Controlling how much we eat at meals and between meals is discipline. Not marrying and forbidding others to marry is asceticism. Choosing not to marry because I'm planning to do mission work in a difficult or rough environment in the Middle East or in Africa somewhere is self-discipline. In conclusion, if we are ever going to mature as Christians, we've got to learn the power that's in self-discipline. God is pleased with you as his child. When you apply the word, you become not hearers, but doers of the word. Becoming a doer of the word requires self-discipline. Paul said it again in this way. He says, when I was a child, I thought as a child, I understood as a child, and I spoke as a child. But when I became a man, I put away those childish things. He put those childish things behind him.
Amen.
God is waiting on us to become mature adults in the word. He's waiting on us to become self-disciplined. And I can preach all day about worship services, studying your Bible, praying, teaching the lost, seeing the needs of another person who is less fortunate, getting involved in the work of the church, rather than let everybody, you know, let a few other people do all the work and show up for all the comforts of their work. Countless other things that we need to be doing as Christians, but it wouldn't be.
We hope you enjoyed today's service of Love Fellowship Believers. Here we're desiring to fulfill God's will. We want him to be pleased with everything that we're doing. We ask that you come out and fellowship with us. Join us. We're at the North Carolina Agricultural Technical State University Alumni Event Center. here in the beautiful city of Greensboro. We want you to come on out, join us, have a ball. Come see what God is doing here with us. Remember, God loves you, and so do I.